Welcome to week two of the program. So we have Piotr Sulkowski from University of Warsaw. He will tell us about topological strings, knots, and quivers.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me? You can, I hope. Okay, so thank you for a chance to speak here. I'm supposed to give two lectures, and it is supposed to be a mini course. So I know that there are some experts in these topics in the audience, but probably also non-experts, so I would be addressing whatever I say primarily to non-experts. This is roughly the what I'm going to present in those topics. I will start with reviewing some classical knot invariants and topics which are probably well known, at least to some of you. And the first talk will be rather a review of some topics from a few years ago. And then in the second talk, I will present some more material, and in particular, this relation to quivers, which is somehow new. But I will start quite slowly. In fact, I will start from knots. So there are these three topics in my title: topological strings, knots, and quivers. As I just said, the relation to quivers will show up only tomorrow, I suppose. And there are indeed some relations between topological strings and knots, but I will start with knots because they are, in a sense, somehow simpler. And then we will see how various quantities, and in particular some knot invariants, can be computed from some physical approaches, in particular related to string theory. So just to make sure that we follow the same notations, knots are simply some closed loops in three-dimensional manifold. Quite often I will be considering just as free as this 3D manifold, but you can consider more general free manifolds. And the simplest example is just a loop, which is also called a trivial knot. Next to simple example is so-called trefoil knot. And then the next example, if I'm drawing it right, is figure eight knot. So again, these are some standard names which I will be using. And then there are more complicated knots. So already I'm doing here some specific specialization. I have some specific viewpoint of knots. Of course, I cannot draw them in three dimensions. What I'm doing, I'm drawing a projection on two-dimensional plane. And I'm doing this projection in such a way that I minimize the number of crossings here. So you see that in these diagrams I have some crossings, and of course I could, without changing a type of a knot, add some additional crossings, but I draw the minimal possible number, so this knot has zero crossings. This is also denoted as zero with index one. Zero means that there are no crossings, and one is just a single knot of this type. Trefoil knot is, in fact, the only knot which has three crossings as this minimal number. So this is also denoted in this way. Figure 8 is the only knot which has four crossings. So this is denoted in this way. You see that there are no knots with two crossings, because if you would draw something that has two crossings, you could easily unwind it to zero crossings. It would be topologically trivial. And then there are more complicated knots. For example, there are two knots which have two crossings. I will not draw them, because I would have to play maybe a bit too much time here, but you can easily find in Google how they look like, 5-1 and 5-2. So these are two knots which have five crossings, but they are topologically different. That's why this index distinguishes them. There are three knots which have six crossings, and so on. So this number is growing very fast. There are almost 200 knots which have 10 crossings, so they are really complicated. So a dream of mathematicians is to classify this knot somehow and have some tools which will distinguish one knot from another. And to this end, they introduce something which is called invariants. Namely, invariants are some simpler objects, not knots like geometric ones, but maybe some numbers or functions which you can compute. For example, looking at the diagram of a knot, then you may compute them for different knots. If you get different answers, then you may be sure that these knots which you look at are different. Let me also mention that there are similar objects called links. They look like nodes, but they have several components. So that's the simplest non-trivial object, which is called hopf link. These are like two annodes, but linked together. And of course, there are more complicated ones. There are big tables. You can also easily find them in the internet. So a holy grail for mathematicians, or at least for knot theorists, is to find some invariant which would be perfect in a sense that if you compute this invariant in some algorithmic way, then you are sure what knot you are talking about. And in fact, such invariant is not known, at least doesn't seem to be known effectively at this stage, but this is what is the main hope for knot theorists. So let me also mention that the topological equivalence of these knots can be reduced to a simple operations of on these diagrams. Namely, there are certain moves, some operations you can make with these diagrams, which are called Rademeister moves. And the claim is that if you can transform one knot or one diagram into another diagram by some sequence of these moves, it means that these two knots are topologically equivalent. So, and these diagrams are really simple. The first one is just like making a loop on a piece of a string. The second move is taking two parallel strings and then putting one of them above the other. So they are very intuitive, as you see. And the third move involves three pieces of a string. So you have like a crossing and an additional vertical line, and then you move this vertical line over this crossing. And this third Rademeister move, in fact, this is quite important, and it makes contact with this parallel program which we have here on integrability, because you might be aware that this picture looks very similar to what you have behind the Young-Baxter equation, and this is also the origin of integrability behind various knot invariants. So these are some operations that mathematicians use to show equivalence of knots. But instead of playing just with figures and diagrams, they are more powerful ways to determine whether two knots are equivalent or not. And some of them are known as these classical knot invariants, in particular polynomial knot invariants. So, as the name indicates, these are some polynomials which you can assign to a given knot or a link. There are polynomials in one or more variables, and there are some ways to compute them just algorithmically from a picture or from a diagram of a given knot. And originally they were found by mathematicians, but we will see soon that they make contact with physics. So the first one was found already in almost 100 years ago. It is called Alexander polynomial. It was 1928. And then there was a longer gap until Jones made a discovery of what we call now Jones polynomial. That was in 1994, and in particular, he got Fields Medal for that. So this Jones polynomial will occur quite often in what I will be discussing. I will typically denote it as J for Jones polynomial with the argument Q. It depends on one variable. And this Jones polynomial, let me tell you how it is defined, because it is also quite important. So one way to define is to use so-called Skine relation, which involves these knot diagrams in some way, and in a sense, this is recursion relation, which looks like this. In fact, it doesn't involve the whole diagram of a given knot, but it, to apply this Skine relation, you have to focus on some local region of this diagram, on one of the crossings that you have. Let me explain slowly what I mean here. So let's say we focus on this trefoil diagram. We have to focus on one crossing, let's say this one. We also have to introduce some orientation to apply that. And once we focus on this crossing, it could be of one of the two types, either this one or this one. So we have identified what kind of crossing it is, and then we have to consider two other knots, which are obtained from the first one by replacing this particular crossing either by this opposite crossing or by this resolution. In this way, we obtain three knots. And the claim is that if you compute Jones polynomial for each of these three knots, we obtain three results which are related by this equation. So together with some initial condition, which we can choose, for example, in such a way that Jones polynomial for the unknot is equal to one, it turns out that you can compute Jones polynomial for any knot, decomposing diagrams, I mean simplifying them maybe in many steps, and reducing to the unknot or to the bunch of unknots. And then also, for example, using this Rademeister moves, you can show that these polynomials which you obtain are indeed invariants. So as an exercise, well, that's right. So, it depends also a bit on the normalization which you choose. This is in fact not the simplest normalization for this connected piece, but if you choose another normalization, that you know that Jones polynomial does factorizes for links. So maybe just as an exercise, I will not do this trefoil example in all detail, but if you have not done this exercise before, let me do the first step. So if we focus again on this crossing, I drew it again. In fact, we have to rotate this picture so that these arrows are opposite, are pointing upwards. So then you see that this arrow is, would be going from southwest to northeast upward. So this crossing would be just the same as this crossing. And then we have to replace this crossing by the opposite crossing. So in this case, we would simply get this picture, so you can see that this is simply the unknot. And if we consider this resolution, so for the unknot, the result is simply one, so we don't have to worry about this piece. But then if we consider this resolution, here we will obtain the Hopfling, for which the polynomial is non-trivial. So then you would have to consider the hop fling, so you again would have to focus on one of these two crossings and then make the same step, and at the end you should find that for trefoil you get such a result. So I may leave it as the exercise, and if you would like to test something more complicated, then for figure 8 knot, which we have also in that figure, you should get the following result. So this is one of the simplest knot polynomials. Soon after Jones found this one, there was another important discovery of so-called Homfly-PT polynomial. So this is a polynomial which depends on two variables. It is defined by its kind of relation, which is generalization of that one. In what follows, I will often denote it as P of A and Q. And well, essentially what I do, I change those Qs on the left-hand side by another variable, which is called A. And it turns out that it also leads to an invariant of a knot, which now depends on two variables. And then this Alexander, in particular, this Alexander polynomial, which I mentioned in the beginning, it can be obtained as a specialization of this Homfly-PT polynomial. When we set A to 1, we get the Alexander. So this is, well, more or less what mathematicians found in the 80s. This was a big breakthrough, this Johnson-Homfly polynomials, which gave a lot of impetus for the whole knot theory in the next couple of decades. And I suppose this is all the information that we need from, let's say, mathematics side. But now I should also remind that this, all these results have physics interpretation, which was found in 1989 by Witten in terms of Simon's theory. So I suppose many of you have heard of this result, but I will quickly review it anyway, also to fix the notation, which we will need later on. So Simon's theory, as I suppose many of you know, is a theory which is this gauge theory, which is topological. This is its section. And well, as it is, it doesn't involve the metric in any way, which is the reason why when we compute it for, we can evaluate the section on some free manifold, M3. And we can also compute a path integral of this theory on some free manifold. Let me denote it in this way. We have to choose some gauge group. I denote it just by G here. Let's say it's a compact gauge group. And because of topological invariance of this section, one statement is that this path integral is a topological invariant of this underlying free manifold. So as you see, of course, it depends on the free manifold that we choose for which we want to compute the invariant. It also may depend on the gauge group that we choose. And in addition, it depends on the coupling, which I denote here. It is often called level. So one discovery of Witten was that this is indeed the invariant of free manifolds, so quite a powerful invariant. But then more importantly, what he found is that when we compute Wilson loop observables, they are closely related to this mathematical not invariants considered by mathematicians a few years earlier. So by Wilson loops observable, I understand the following expectation value in Chern-Simons theory trace of the exponent of this gauge connection integrated along some path. This path I denote by capital K, not to be confused with small k. And in particular, I can take this capital K to be just identified with some knot. And then when evaluating this trace, I can also evaluate it in some representation. For example, for a SUN gauge group, all these representations are labeled by Young diagrams. And then what Witten found is, first of all, that for some particular choice of the gauge group, which is just SU2, and fundamental representation, this path integral normalized by this partition function gives Jones polynomial. And more generally, we can obtain other invariants, such as Comfy polynomial, and even more general, which generalize this previously found polynomial not invariants. So if I take, let me now focus just on S3. If I take gauge group to be SUN, and let me say that I take arbitrary representation. And it turns out that this normalized Wilson loop produces something which is called colored Comfy PT polynomial. In particular, if this R would be just fundamental representation, I would get ordinary Comfy PT polynomial, which, as I just mentioned, is defined by these kind relations. So the way Witten showed this, essentially, he argued how to obtain this kind of relations from topological invariants of this Chern-Simons theory. Yeah, indeed. So this is quite non-trivial. One has too much various parameters. You see that this this ratio depends on this small k and capital N, the choice of the gauge group, and to relate it to Comfy polynomial, we need to relate these variables in some way, and this is quite a non-trivial relation. So Q, which appears in Comfy polynomial, is exponent of 2 pi I over k plus n, and then a is simply q to power n. So that's one important identification. And also, just as an example, let me write down, we will need this result later on, it will be quite important. But so if we choose fundamental representation, so this R, I denote just by a simple box. This is this ordinary Comfy PT polynomial. this takes the following form. And in particular, if you set A to BQ square, which means you would focus just on SU2 gauge group, then you would get Jones polynomial, which are have written before. And this is for trefoil. Oh, sorry, for trefoil. So for the unknot, depends on the normalization. One normalization is suggest you take the Humphrey polynomial also to be one, or what you would get more directly from this approach, you may choose it to be so-called quantum dimension for the unknot. And well, I will also use often the notation. So often I will consider symmetric representations. I mean symmetric powers of the fundamental representations, and in that case I will write simply P with index R instead of writing this expression. Okay, and maybe as yet another example. This is a to power 4, at least in the notation I used. So this was q square plus q to power 6 minus q to power 8, right? I hope this is what I wrote before. Okay, sorry, that should have been q to the 8 in that case. Yeah. So it might be not quite obvious how to get these colored polynomials directly from this path integral formulation, but you can get these colored polynomials also from so-called cabling formulas if you know some representation theory. So these formulas are such that if you have, let me write them, maybe for simplicity with an example, just for the Jones polynomial, if you have a sum of representations for some knot, I mean Jones polynomial computed for the representation, which is a sum of several others, then this is equal just to sum of Jones polynomial in those different representations. And on the other hand, if you have tensor power of some representation, then it can be related to so-called cable of a knot, which means you take n strands. I will take nth power of this representation R, and then I relate it to an object which looks like original knot, but this is made of n strands. So then the statement is that, they are related simply in this way. I replace those n strands by the nth power of a given representation. So, for example, from this, the composition of the product of two-dimensional representations, we can, using these relations, quickly find that the second symmetric representation, Jones polynomial colored by second symmetric representation, can be evaluated in this way. And then as a second exercise, you may try to see that for the trefoil knot, the second symmetric representation, you get the following result. Okay, so this is how this classical polynomial invariants may be interpreted in some physical terms. Oh, this is no. This is tensor product for this just representation, and this power, as I say, this is just replacing a knot by something made of n strands. So, of course, this is very important work. This relation to Simon's theory. And one important feature is that it gives you like really three-dimensional perspective on knots. You don't need to look just at diagrams. You have some way of thinking of this knot invariants from three-dimensional perspective. So that's one of the importance of that work. And we will need, in fact, all these colored polynomials also in what follows. But for a moment, I will remind about one other invariant, which is called A polynomial. So let me say now I focus on the second section. Namely, A polynomial Andrew Carson relations. So this A polynomial, this is also some invariant, but of somewhat other flavor than this invariants which I presented so far. Namely, it has some geometric meaning. You can think of this object A polynomial as some algebraic curve which is associated to a knot, and in some way it encodes some information about so-called knot group. For example, of a knot. That's one way to think of that. So let me tell you first how it is defined, and then I will tell you how these recursion relations are related to the same polynomial. Maybe I could also add here volume conjecture, because all this is related. So, well, I will be rather brief, but what I want to consider now is the fundamental group of a complement of a knot in S3. So I take S3, if I have some knot that I consider its tubular neighborhood. So instead of infinitely thin strand, I consider something of finite width and remove it from S3. So then I get knot complement by this N, I mean tubular. Neighborhood. And then consider the fundamental group of that. So, for example, for a trefoil knot, this fundamental group is a simple example of the braid group. It is generated by two generators, N, A, B, which satisfy the following relations. And in fact, these fundamental groups are also invariants of knots. However, they are a bit difficult to work with because they are non-commutative and it's hard to discuss them in some situations or just play with them. So it is useful to consider representations from those fundamental groups into SL2C, for example. And then if we consider that, then in particular, we can also focus on the boundary of this complement, which is essentially the same as the boundary of this tubular neighborhood, which is just a topologically just that the two torus, which means that the pi 1 of this boundary is simply z times z, because we have two independent cycles. And so let me denote the generators of, well, these two basic generating cycles, or I mean generators of this pi 1, are two basic cycles which are called meridian and longitude. Which are denoted M and L. And so under this homomorphism rho, they are represented by some two matrices. Which have to commute. That's because the pi 1 of this boundary is z2. And because they commute, then by conjugation, they can be put in the Jordan form. So essentially, they can be brought to like over diagonal forms. And then all the information about the knot group, and so also about the knot, which we have here, is encoded in these two complex numbers, x and y, which in addition cannot be equal to zero. So essentially, to each such representation row, we assign two numbers, x and y. And furthermore, it can be shown that this x and y, they cannot be independent, but they have to satisfy some algebraic relation. And this relation is referred to as this A polynomial. So this characterizes a knot that we started with. And one may also notice that flat connections on M, in fact, are also classified by such homomorphisms. So one can think of this A as labeling a representation of Chern-Simons theory with SL2C gauge group, which gives also the relation of yet another relation in particular of this object to this Chern-Simons theory. And so this A polynomial was found in a paper. Well, the references I am going are not very precise. If you are interested, I may give more precise a bit later. But there is a bunch of authors with initials CCG, LNS. That was the year 1994. And this is where the A polynomial is introduced. However, what is important is for us, it will be important that the A polynomial is related to this colored Jones polynomials that I introduced earlier. So even though this definition seems it is much different and at first sight it doesn't seem closely related, in fact it is. And I should also stress that you can think of this algebraic relation as representing some algebraic curve, because x and y are just complex variables, so such a relation defines some algebraic curve, and this gives some geometric way of thinking of knot invariants. Well, it follows from the constraints which come from the from this knot group, essentially. So for different knots, you had different knot groups, and these constraints somehow represent the relations in that group. Yes. M, this M you mean? Well, one of the, I'm not sure if some linear combination, so one of them is, well, they go along these two cycles of a torus one, so one of them is clearly non-contractible. But the other one, should be contractible. Of yes. Yeah, so sure, that's one, in a sense, that's one manifestation of that relation. Okay, maybe just to give also one example for a trefoil knot that we considered in many cases, let me just write how this A polynomial looks like, and we will come across it again a bit later, so maybe then I will comment a bit more on the structure of this result. But now let me just say that there is some universal piece, which is this y minus 1, and then another piece, and you see that everything is rather simple, just polynomial form in these two variables, x and y. So, I wanted to be rather brief on just on this definition, but what I'd like to stress more is that this A polynomial is related to those colored Jones polynomials we had before through so-called volume conjectures, and there are various incarnations of these conjectures. The first one. Discovered by Zayev in 97 is such that for knots, at least for a large class of knots, which are called hyperbolic ones, which means that this knot complement that I mentioned, there is a hyperbolic manifold. First of all, the Jones polynomial colored by representations, by representations with higher and higher spin, it has something to do with the volume of this hyperbolic manifold. So if you evaluate this Jones polynomial at roots of unity chosen in such a way, so exponents of 2 pi I over r, where r is the same r which I am taking here. And then, well, compute log of that, it turns out that also divide by r, that this reproduces the hyperbolic volume for this knot complement with appropriate hyperbolic metric chosen. So that's one statement. And there is another statement we would be more interested in, which I will refer to as generalized volume conjecture. That's something that also Sergei Gukov, who is here, discussed. Namely, one can consider a more general family of hyperbolic matrix on this knot complement, and then one can consider Jones polynomial evaluated, let's say, at arbitrary q, which I will represent as exponent of h bar. So what I'm doing more or less is just rewriting this relation in a bit different form, but also in more general context, not just focusing on those roots of unity. And I'm considering such a limit that r goes again to infinity and q goes to 1, or in other words, h bar goes to 0, in such a way that r times h bar are fixed, and then I denote q to power r by x, which is fixed or constant. And it turns out that in this limit, this color Jones polynomials have the following asymptotic expansion, where the first term in this expansion, S0, is closely related to an algebraic curve which can be identified with this A polynomial. And, well, that's interesting, first of all, because we find some relation between this classical polynomial invariants like Kolor-Jones and this geometric object A polynomial. And as I say, this relation just in this form holds for this first term. But we can see that we have also something like a quantum expansion. You can think of this expansion or these other terms as some quantum corrections to this classical results, to this classical piece. And this gives you some framework to apply various ideas from quantization. In particular, it gives you some ways to analyze all this series of quantum corrections. So let me be a bit more precise. How the A polynomial enters here, namely, it turns out that this S0 of x can be computed simply in this way, where this A, Y and X satisfy a relation which is the same algebraic equation as the A polynomial that we found. So in other words, this leading term as zero, or you may say that this A polynomial knows about this leading term as zero, and then you might also ask whether these higher terms are related in some way to those classical polynomials that we had, and they indeed do. So this is the statement of yet another version of this volume conjecture, which is then referred to as quantum volume conjecture. Of course, you have to plug in the appropriate one. Okay. Yeah, this is, I think, what Sergey mentioned. Yeah, that in this limit, you just see this contribution of the most dominant part. Okay, so so let me say, yeah, that there is this quantum version of the statement. Namely, it turns out that one can write some recursion relations it turns out that one can write down a certain recursion relation which I will write in operator form, which relates these different color Jones polynomials to each other. So this x hat and y hat, which are here, are operators which satisfy Weyl algebra. And they act in such a way that x acting on jr gives us jr multiplied by x, and y hat acting on jr shifts this index r by one. So in other words, this relation, more explicitly, it could be written in such a way that we have some coefficients. So if this is written as a polynomial with some coefficients ai, and this relation takes the following form. And what is quite surprising is that now one can take simply a classical limit of this operator. In this limit, x and y start to commute, so they behave just like ordinary commuting numbers, and this dependence on q drops out. And it turns out that in this limit, we obtain, again, this A polynomial, classical A polynomial, possibly up to some very simple factor, which for a moment we will ignore. So in that sense, this operator A hat may be thought of as quantization of this algebraic curve. And that's why also this is often referred to as quantum curve. So from that perspective, you may also realize that this A hat, while this classical curve A knows just about this A0, this A hat itself, in a sense, knows about all these corrections, because when you apply these recursions, you are able to find all Collard-Jones polynomials, not only for infinite R, but also for all values of R. Okay, and this quantum volume conjecture, this is essentially this statement. And, well, I don't have that much time left. Maybe I will give a side remark that you might also find these other core quantum corrections by using so-called topological recursions, which are certain, this is a certain framework, which comes from matrix models. And, well, I don't have time to discuss it too much, so let me just give references. There was one work by Digraph, Fuji, and Manabe, and later another work by Gaetan Boro and Einhardt. And then we had a paper also with Sergey, where we discuss how to use those topological recursions to recover A hat just from this classical curve. So these recursions are, well, quite universal, very strong apparatus, which, as you see in example of this system, it enables you to find quantum answers just from the knowledge of the classical result. So, okay, I think this is the moment where I more or less discard various incarnations of the Jones polynomial and Collard-Jones polynomial and this kind of quantization problem. I'm not sure how much time do I still have. Around 10 minutes. How about this knot homologies, which nonetheless are, you may think of this as a modern incarnation of knot theory. So these are also not invariants, however, more involved. These are not just polynomials or some numerical invariants, but some more interesting mathematical objects, like some spaces, which are assigned to knots. And the motivation to find them was to explain a certain surprising fact, which I didn't stress so far, but that's very important, namely the coefficients of those knot polynomials which I discussed are integer, which is a very non-trivial statement. If you look at this kind of relations I wrote and play with them a bit, you will see that, well, when you play with them, there are some ratios which you have take. So first of all, it's not quite obvious at all that like this Jones polynomial that you obtain at the end would be really a polynomial. And furthermore, it's not obvious that it would have integer coefficient. So like the general idea and solution to this problem is to present these coefficients. If they are integers, then the natural suspicion is that they count something. Mathematicians typically count some dimensions. So the general hope is that these not invariants appear as combinations of certain dimensions of this homological spaces. So I will write now some more general formula, which hopefully illustrates the idea. So I'll write it just in the case of those colored monthly PT polynomials, and then the hope is that this colored comfy PT could be represented in such a way. So this expression looks more or less like a characteristic for the homologies of a complex of certain spaces, which are just given here. And what we deal with, looking at these polynomials, are just dimensions of those spaces. So such an idea have been made precise, first of all, by Kovanov. Where he defined this homological invariants in the case of Jones polynomial. So that's one important reference. And let me also say that these invariants have physical representation in a string theory context. I will tell about more about those string theory representations in the second lecture. But let me already stress that the idea here is to identify these spaces as spaces of certain BPS states in some brain system in string theory. So this is one reason why those not homologies are of so much interest to string theorists as well, among others by the relation to these brain systems and BPS states. And moreover, so once we have this expression, you see that it looks like Euler characteristic, and so it can be simply generalized to more general polynomial, which is a bit like in between these classical polynomials and these homological spaces. Namely, we can introduce a new variable, which I call T. And then I also get some interesting knot invariant, which knows a bit more than those classical invariants. And I should also stress that finding this knot homology is quite difficult. It's been done in some cases, like in this Kovanov case, or for so-called SLN invariants. There is so-called Kovanov-Rozhansky homology. So that's another reference I should stress. This is for SLN invariants. Original Kovanov work is just for Jones, namely SL2. But at the moment, we don't have an explicit formulation of this most general setup, namely colored homology homologies. However, what we can do by some physical approaches, we can find these super polynomials. Even if we don't know full homologies, we are able to identify those super polynomials in various independent ways. And they already give us some information about these homologies. So we hope that this information at least might be like a guiding principle to formulating full colored Chomsky homologies. So as a very short review, these super polynomials can be found, as I say, by several means, and they give the results which coincide, so that's very encouraging. So the first one is so-called refined Chern-Simons theory. This is the idea proposed by Mina Aganagic and Shamil Shakirov. I think it was around 2011. So essentially, this is a refinement of the computations that you typically do in Chern-Simons theory. The second approach is to use certain structural properties that we expect that these Chomsky homologies should have. In particular, there are a bunch of differentials in these homologies, which impose certain constraints also on the level of superpolynomials. So assuming that these structural properties should hold, at least in some cases, they are so constraining that they determine these superpolynomials exactly. And there are also relations, oh, sorry, let me also stress that these have been used by Dunfield. Sergei Gukov and Rasmussen in 2005, and then also in case of colored homologies by Sergei Gukov and Marko Stosic in 2011. So as you see, the topic is very vast, and I'm not able to present too much detail of all the corners I would like to, but at least I hope that giving these references will guide you if you would like to look at more details. And then finally, there is approach based on double affine Hecke algebras, which works, for example, for torus knots, which also gives results which agree with some other approaches. So to conclude, let me give you just one example how such super polynomials look like. Well, first of all, because you would like to see that this is indeed the effective approach, namely we can compute something, so that's good. And on the other hand, this is the results that we get are nonetheless quite non-trivial, and there is a lot of behind them. So again, for trefoil knot, I can write how the super polynomial looks like in arbitrary symmetric representation. And the answer is the following. So this is just the answer. I should say that this symbol XQ, it will appear many times, probably tomorrow as well. This is Q Pochhammer, which means the following product. And then this R over K, this is Q binomial symbol, namely in my notation, combination of those you. Hammers. So what you can try to do is to convince yourself that, first of all, this formula gives you polynomial, which indeed has finite number of terms, and it has all signs positive. So from this expression, it immediately follows that this object should be polynomial, which has only positive signs. This is not quite obvious, because we have some negative signs here, for example. So there must be some cancellations, which leave us just with positive terms. And you can also make sure, maybe I will write as the last thing, what we get when we take r equal 1, then we get super polynomial in this fundamental representation. And this is some result which we also, we will need it quite much tomorrow. So of course, this is some Q deformation of this Humphrey polynomial I already presented before. It looks like this. And well, then if you set t to be minus 1, then you should get Humphrey polynomial, which I had before. So we indeed do. We get these two terms with positive sign. And because here is t cube, when we set t to be minus 1, we get minus a to power 4, which we somehow had before. So there are many other things you can do with this expression. I will maybe discuss them tomorrow. And I think I should stop now. Thank you.
Questions?
So you mentioned that the Jones polynomial is killed by this A polynomial, or A
colored Jones. Colored.
Is something similar true here as well? Is there a
exactly? Yeah. So that's what is a kind of the next point, which I thought I will discuss still today, but I will mention that tomorrow. But the answer is yes.
And what is the interpretation of these A's and T's? Because Q was e to the h bar for you.
So what they just appear as parameters. So you get like an algebraic curve, but with coefficients which depend on A and T.
Other questions? So I had a quick question. So which of these invariants, say, for example, detect the unknot?
So I think there is a theorem that does Kovanov homology detect the unknot? Kovanov homology detects the unknot.
Any other questions? Okay, if not, we'll thank the speaker again.